Hi, this is Dr. Robert Berry. I'm an orthopedic spine surgeon with over 30 years experience, and the topic we're going to be referring to is called cervical radiculopathy. Cervical radiculopathy, by definition, is pain, numbness, or tingling that can start in the neck, maybe out into the shoulder, and down into the arm. It has a variety of presentations and can go to back to the scapular area. It could just present as numbness in the hands, and has to be fully evaluated. Believe it or not, the usual cause of this is not trauma. That would be maybe one out of five patients that get it from an automobile accident or a fall or another form of trauma. Usually, it's a slowly developing degeneration in the neck that causes a pinching of the nerve that manifests itself as mild to moderate pain down the arm that simply does not go away. The causes. The neck has seven vertebral areas. They slowly degenerate over time where they lose their water content. They shrink down, and that results in a bulging that goes out to the side and can catch the nerve. You can have an acute ruptured disc that can be seen on an MRI, or you can have stenosis that basically develops over time. And the stenosis is basically a narrowing of that tunnel that the nerves come out through after they branch off the spinal cord and then go down the arm. That's something that's fairly easily seen on MRI. So the causes can be a bulging disc, they can be a ruptured disc, they can be stenosis, and they can be seen in videos that show exactly what they look like. How does it present? As I mentioned, in a variety of forms, but to the point where you know something's wrong, and you typically start out with perhaps your primary healthcare advisor. You end up seeing some professional. If I was seeing you, basically I'd sit you down, I'd take the history, I would check your reflexes, I would check your strength, I would check your sensation, do a full neurological evaluation. Based on that, most of us would order a set of x-rays. This can include flexion extension views and some special views. Other studies, and especially the most critical study, is an MRI. The MRI is, in almost all cases, extremely accurate. Shows the condition going on, how severe the nerve is pinched, what the source of it is, how many levels are involved, what would need to be treated. So after you are sent to a study, which would include the x-rays and MRI, then the determination is whether this is operative or non-operative. Believe it or not, over 50% or over half the patients get better with natural healing and some other measures over time and do not require surgery. So treatments that your professional may recommend would be a soft cervical collar, just a rest, and rest itself where you're taking the weight of the head off the neck. It puts pressure on it. Decrease your activities, caution with the lifting, twisting, and bending. I may recommend physical therapy, may recommend traction. You might get an EMG or further studies. And then basically you're waiting for natural healing. The indications for surgery are you have failed that conservative treatment over a minimal period of time, or you have gotten dramatically worse, or you have significant neurological deficit that has to be attended to immediately. Then we get to surgical options. In general, this surgery is highly successful, with some articles reporting 85 to 90% success rates. And so the odds are that you will do very well with it. But let me talk about the procedures. Number one is what I had done. I had a two-level, severely pinched off nerve roots, horrible arm pain that just wasn't responsive to any treatment. And I had a two-level fusion. So the first one is an anterior cervical discectomy and fusion. We go in through the neck. It's a small incision. We try to stay in natural creases along the neck to keep it as cosmetically appealing as possible. It typically takes an hour to two. The second procedure is artificial disc replacement, which is very popular now. And I like them. I like them quite a bit. They've been cleared by the FDA for certain levels. You can have one level. For some types, you can have two levels. But the advantage to the cervical disc replacement is it maintains, obviously, some motion in the neck. It allows early return to work. and actually has excellent results. The third procedure is a posterior laminectomy, and that's where we go in the back of the neck and also can decompress the nerve from the back of the neck. In each one of these procedures, patients need to remember that the first part, the most important part actually, is taking the pressure off the nerve root. That's removing the disc. That's taking the bone spurs down. That's making the tunnel that the nerves go through perfectly open, and you can actually feel it at that time. That's the most important part. The stabilization is important, but all are very successful. The fusion is successful. The artificial disc is successful. The laminectomy can be successful. Recovery. Recovery is mostly an outpatient, but can be a one-night stay. And if you're doing a multi-level, very complicated neck, it can be even longer than that. Most patients are typically up and walking the same day. They're typically eating the first day, although we really ask that they take liquids, soft foods, until the swallowing turns around, because one of the complications that is basically universal, because the surgery is done right down by the esophagus, there is some traction on the esophagus, that results in typically short-term difficulty swallowing. For me, it was 3 or 4 days, and I was fine after that. Some people are longer than that. Some people are shorter than that. Also, you can have some short-term hoarseness because there's a little nerve that sits down, and that can be a little stretched or a little pulled. That usually resolves over time as well. You may have to wear a soft collar. The surgeon may have you wear a hard collar. Return to work really kind of depends on what type of work you do and what type of procedure you have. So I've had some patients go back in a couple of days. I've had people who do hard labor who have to stay off for 2 to 3 months to make sure that they're fully stabilized and not at risk for re-injury. Driving is between you and your surgeon, but definitely it's when you're off opiates and then the surgeon feels you're safe enough to drive. Back to normal activities, that's highly variable too in what you call normal activities. But let's say you're a high output athlete. That could take 2 to 3 weeks to start to slowly get into your routine. Some people want to know when they can travel. Depending on the procedure, again, that can be pretty quick. I've had patients that had to get across the country, that a meeting they had to be in, and I'll actually let them go within 4 or 5 days, provided they keep their collar on, they're safe. They sit in an aisle seat, something where it's easy to get in and out of. Full recovery is different for different people, but I will say that this is a high satisfaction surgery. Most people do extremely well with it. Most people, not all, feel some significant relief in the postoperative phase. What they'll typically feel, I'll use myself and my patients as an example, is that the pain will be moderate to significantly improved within a week or two. The numbness and tingling could last longer because that means when you ruptured or when you had stenosis that it actually injured the nerve. I can take the pressure off the nerve root, but it has to heal itself over time. And that can actually take, in real severe cases, up to 6 months to a year. But most people are having noticeable change within a pretty short period of time. So that is my take on cervical radiculopathy. We have some excellent videos that show the condition, the procedure, and I'll be discussing those videos. Thank you for your time.